hard-hitting analysis. I don't understand how he doesn't provide more. Why don't we have him on a desk?
He's going to take a lot of damage, and they are just gunning them down. CLG, once again, is prepared for this. It's already over!
We talk about a lot of different esports and games on Squad, but there is one in particular that we like to keep a close eye on. I'm talking about Rainbow Six Siege. Luckily for all of us, we have caster Interro calling in to discuss everything Rainbow Six. How's it going?
It's going well. How are you on this rainy day today?
I know. So great now that we're talking to you. We really want to get to know you better because you were such a big personality in the scene. So I want to hear your origin story. How did you get into casting in the first place?
It was just one of those things where you have, a good enough voice for people, or, you know, a voice for radio or whatever you want to call it. And the more that you play, you slowly start to accumulate the, like, this number of people that say, like, you have a really nice voice. Like, have you ever considered casting? And I had a couple friends who were competing in an event for this tiny league. The original caster's computer blew up and they needed somebody to step in. And I said, you know what? I've never casted this game before, but I'll give it a whirl and see how it goes. And reception was great. I really enjoyed it, and I just kind of fell into it, and I was like, this is a decent hobby. Next thing you know, I'm offered a job a couple months later, and that was September 2017. It's been a nice solid 2 years since.
I like how you remember the exact date. It's like an anniversary for you. So did you even go to school for it? Like, did you do broadcasting or any of the studies part of it?
No, funny enough, my first choice actually out of high school was radio and television broadcasting when that's what it was called at Ryerson. I got waitlisted and I was a little impatient, so I accepted an offer to go and study political sciences. So that's what I did in university, a double major program alongside what was originally economics and then international development. So it doesn't really prepare you for this industry, but through university, I did, you know, I did Model United Nations, I did debating. I worked in politics itself and did a lot of the rigmarole there. And I think that the retail politics experience helps you an awful lot at being comfortable speaking to people and speaking well. And it set me up in a way that I didn't really anticipate, but it's been a very, you know, great asset to me so far.
That's interesting. I'm sure a lot of people who want to become casters look to you a lot, you know, oftentimes for this kind of advice. But I want to know about, like, Rainbow Six specifically. What was it about the game that, I guess, you decided to dedicate yourself to?
I was actually looking to see if I had it within arm's reach. I unearthed my old copy of Rainbow Six from back in 2004 when I started playing this game originally, obviously not Rainbow Six Siege. I skipped out on the Rainbow Six Vegas franchise, but then I heard a lot of good things about Siege, and I was ready to give the franchise another go. I originally came from Call of Duty, and I was looking for something just with a bit more depth, as I felt like Call of Duty got a bit too casual for my liking over the years. And I had a couple friends, they recommended Rainbow Six Siege. They say, you know, it's a very cerebral shooter. It does a lot of things that nothing else does on the market. It scratches an itch that we didn't know needed to be scratched. So why not? I picked it up on the Steam winter sale for like $20, and I was hooked immediately. It just the sophistication required, the amount of ways that you can do the same thing but with just small changes. It was great, and every single time you play it, it's like you discover something new.
Interesting. Now, you've been casting for the league for a while now, and I feel like the Rainbow Six is interesting. You guys have your broadcast like at Katowice, but you guys do a lot of online interviews as well. So what has it, you know, how has the experience been the last couple of years casting?
It's been an interesting adjustment to move continents, and it's kind of wreaked havoc on your schedule, right? We're going around and traveling quite a lot, especially with the schedule we're on right now being quite condensed. So we've doubled up the amount of broadcasts that we do per week. We'll do 3 broadcasts per duo, so 6 shows a week. And it basically ends up being that half of the season is done in 4 to 5 weeks. Which gives us a lot more time to travel. It's great because I can come home and I can see my family, or I can go see friends, or I can go on vacation or whatnot. But somebody who constantly flies, I don't envy the people who are constantly on long flights. I like traveling. I don't like sitting in a plane for 14 hours. Mm-hmm. So being up at weird hours, having to fly across the world, you know, when you're a kid, I think you kind of envy those people who are constantly traveling for work. You think, man, it must be so cool to, you know, always be on planes and in airport lounges. And I got to say, it was. But it's definitely an adjustment, and you need to go into it with a different mindset that I think a lot of Hollywood movies and TV shows kind of prepare you in the wrong ways for. because it's not always as glamorous when, you know, it's been 20 hours since you showered and you're trying to trudge to your destination running on fumes, knowing that you have to be at a rehearsal the next day. It can be a bit of an adjustment.
I was going to ask you, what was your most unglamorous moment? But if, was that a personal story you're alluding to?
There have been times where I was unable to sleep. So I was on a 12 and a half hour flight, give or take, from Amsterdam to L.A. And I'd set myself up so I would sleep on the plane, stayed up all night. And then I discovered the game Undertale on my Nintendo Switch. And I did not stop playing it. And I didn't sleep for any of the flight. And I get to TwitchCon after connecting in L.A. to San Jose. At this point, I've traveled for like 22, 23 hours. Haven't slept, and it's like 2 p.m. And I know I'm gonna be up another 12 hours or so seeing friends. I was a hot mess, so. Yeah.
Oh no, you fell for the Undertale trap. Oh, but I'm sure it was worth it. Let's move on. Let's talk about your first broadcast. Do you remember what it was like casting for the first time in front, like on stream or in front of an audience?
The first time wasn't that bad because there was only like two, three, four viewers. It was a tiny league, and they were probably all bots anyway. But by the end of the broadcast, the people who were competing in the league, I guess they were done their scrims, they started tuning in, and now you've got a dozen people watching you. And it's all people who play in that league, and it's my first time casting. You know, I wasn't a Twitch streamer by any stretch of the imagination, so 12 viewers is massive, you know, for you when you don't usually stream. But then I jumped on board a CCS, which was and is still the largest amateur league for Rainbow Six. And you've got a guy running scenes, you know, and doing transitions, and you've got somebody talking in your ear, and you've got a co-caster now. And like there's like it's a real production. There's like a pro team that's playing in it, and you've got 100 viewers. And that was very nerve-wracking. That was probably my big like, oh my God moment. Like if I screw up, I'm done. And still to this day, that is the most nervous I've ever been casting an event or a league. More nervous than the first day that I casted Pro League in Poland, which I know might be strange, but I felt really at ease being with Kix on that first broadcast. So CCS is still like the, oh my God, if I blow it, I'm done.
It's important to have a good co-caster, I'm sure. You and Kix have such a great relationship. I love it. Now, you are such an integral part of the Rainbow Six Siege scene. You often speak out about issues relevant to the community. So I'm curious, to being in the position that you are in, you know, being a caster, being always visible, do you feel almost like it's your duty to be a spokesperson for the community?
I wouldn't say duty, but I think that when you have a platform, you somewhat have a responsibility to use it appropriately. And for me, I am aware that I have enough people that tune in, be it on stream or be it on Twitter, et cetera, that are curious of my thoughts on things. And one of the, I guess, the holes that Rainbow Six has right now, not just in esports, but also in the actual game and the community itself, is that there's no real institutional knowledge, there's no real elder voices, so to speak, to address issues involving sexism that tends to run in video games, toxicity that's outside of the sexism realm, balancing changes, you know, issues with rosters, issues with orgs not paying players. And I think it's helpful, given that I do have a platform, to lend my voice to those that could use it, either as a signal boost or even just to clarify something, because when there's so many people that are looking for somebody to speak up or to speak out on an issue, somebody has to fill that role. Whether it's me or whether it's somebody else, the message is what's most important, not the fact that I'm saying it. So, like I said, duty, responsibility, I don't know. I would kind of quarrel over whether those words require me to say something. I don't need to, but I think it helps, and I've heard that it does, and that's really all I'm going for.
Yeah, definitely. Let's talk about your most recent announcement, because you on Twitter announced that you were taking kind of a hiatus due to some health issues. So can you go into more detail about that and what went into your decision?
Yeah, I mean, I felt like garbage for a number of months. You know, I landed in LA for E3 at the start of June, and I woke up one morning while I was there, and it just felt like I hadn't slept. It's like that feeling where you stay up until 4 a.m. cramming for an exam, you sleep for an hour, and then you wake up to go to class, and you're hot and irritated, and you're like, I'm gonna dread all of today. I felt like that for 3 months, and I knew something was seriously wrong, because that was a very unusual alien feeling for me. I went to the doctor, and you know, I'm happy to talk about it. I was diagnosed as type 1 diabetic, and it was a bit of a shocker, but I was relieved to know that it's manageable and it wasn't something worse. Not mm-hmm. that it's not bad, but mm-hmm. that I have a support structure. I'm very fortunate to be Canadian, to have a healthcare team, and to, you know, have medication be affordable. I think mm-hmm. those are big things, and I'm very lucky in that regard. But the doctor wanted to ensure that I took it slow and get used to what are going to be significant lifestyle changes and an irritating disease that I will have to babysit for the rest yeah. of my life. It's not fatal, but ESL was kind enough to say, take as much time as you need. And as of a couple days ago, I've been cleared to fly and travel again. So it's right back on the grind.
That's good to hear. Maybe on that note, just to wrap it all up, the talk about health and esports, it feels like something that, you know, we often don't talk about. So in terms of the future, what do you think, what would you like to see in terms of player health, caster health, all of that stuff?
I mean, we're in a kind of a strange situation right now because we're a very closed ecosystem. Mm-hmm. If you look at a game like Counter-Strike, for example, or even somewhat Dota, they have a much more Wild West approach to events where the players are routinely commenting on burnout, on casters talking about, you know, the just sheer volume of events that they have to work. So for us, it's kind of fortunate that we only have, you know, 4 to 8 events a year right now, unless you're counting like regional events like Canadian Nationals, US Nationals, etc. That's good because I don't particularly feel overworked. Mm. The only real downside from my own perspective is that depending on where you put your studio and depending on what region you're casting, you might be working at night. You might be working very similar to shift work. That can be very difficult for your body. And unlike traditional sports, esports, I think, hasn't really concerned itself too much on player exercise, diet, proper breaks, healthcare, etc. And, you know, you see a lot of these gamers that are drinking very sugary energy drinks and not particularly eating well, and they're not sleeping because the only times that they wake up are, you know, 4 or 5 in the afternoon, and then they scrim all night and they sleep all day. These are not healthy ways to live. And I think that a lot of esports orgs are starting to realize that getting a dietitian or getting a professional chef, if they live in a team house, mandating exercise for their players and aligning like their body and mind together, not mm-hmm. just makes them healthier people, but better gamers and better players as well.
That's amazing. I totally agree. We really appreciate your insight, especially on such a serious matter. Interro, thank you so much for calling in.
Thank you very much for having me.